Welcome to The Real News. I'm Mark Steiner. Great to have you all with us once again. The United States has been after Julian Assange for the last 10 years. Ever since he released the Baghdad airstrike collateral murder video, along with the Afghanistan and the Iraq war logs that exposed the war crimes and horrendous nature of the U.S. wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. It led to the jailing of Chelsea Manning and Assange being forced into exile into the Ecuadorian embassy in London. Now, for the last 16 months, he's been held in a high-security prison in Britain and now faces an extradition to be sent to the United States to stand trial. His prosecution and his extradition proceedings are like nothing ever done before. Many hold it violates international laws, not to mention U.S. law, where you cannot prosecute a foreign citizen for these alleged crimes. The Trump administration has done its best to get it done. They've intensified the effort to prosecute and persecute Assange beyond anything that occurred during the Obama administration. So to find out what's going on during this trial and what's been happening in this last week and what happened today, we talk with Kevin Castoza, who is the managing editor of Shadowproof. He is the co-host of the weekly podcast Unauthorized Disclosure and has been following this Assange case for a long time with some real intensity and just spent the last 6 hours watching the trial in London. And Kevin, welcome back. It's good to have you with us here on The Real News once again.
And thanks for having me.
I appreciate your patience as well. I mean, you must be a tired man starting at 5 o'clock this morning.
Yes.
So let's start with trial. So talk about what you just witnessed today. Did anything new come up?
We had the testimony on day 7 from Daniel Ellsberg, Pentagon Papers whistleblower. Huge witness to have in your corner if you're Julian Assange. Managed to line it up. Of course, he was getting up really early because he lives in California. And they only, you know, we have a few of these witnesses that are in the States that you have to work out the time zone difference in order to accommodate them for these proceedings. So that's been an element of trying to make it through all the people that the legal team has for this case. And Daniel Ellsberg testified about the fact that Julian Assange has political opinions and that he would believe that Julian Assange is in fact being targeted for his political opinions. That's important because it's one of the few ways in which they might be able to beat this extradition request, because there is a protection for people who are being targeted for their political opinions, much like there's a protection for people when it comes to race or if they're targeted for their ethnicity or their sexual orientation. That's built into our treaty between the US and the UK. So we spoke about going to London, meeting with Assange, talking about transparency in government and the fact that they both were against the secrecy on the part of the US government when it comes to military affairs and foreign policy, and that they had that in common with each other, that you know, he had this background of releasing the Pentagon Papers back in the around the Vietnam War, and that now you have Julian Assange who's publishing these materials from Chelsea Manning to expose the Afghanistan and the Iraq wars. And so we heard about that, and it was really good for him to be able to share his testimony also about what he experienced when he was put on trial. And that's going to be an important thing for Julian Assange if he's ever brought to the United States and put on trial, because he mentioned, Daniel Ellsberg did, that you can't share your intent or motive in the courtroom. And he recalled that when he was given the opportunity to take the stand, it got to the question that was put to him by his lawyer, you know, why did you do this, essentially? And the prosecutor objected, and the judge would not allow that question to be asked in the middle of the courtroom. And that's going to be something that Julian Assange has to deal with in his case if he's ever brought to the U.S.
So what happened with the prosecution and Ellsberg? I'm very curious. And what more did they do in their questioning of him? And did it have any effect, do you think?
Ellsberg put on a very strong amount of his testimony was very strong in handling what the prosecutor had to throw at him, because the prosecutor's tactic was to suggest that there were people who were put in grave harm by WikiLeaks's disclosures, that by publishing this material that WikiLeaks had blood on their hands. This has been the U.S. government position for some time. And you know, he said, there's no evidence. You've never shown us any examples of individuals. Nobody's ever named these people who were allegedly killed. The government talks figuratively about people who had to flee countries. We just so everyone's clear, there's the U.S. diplomatic cables, and there's also the military reports from Iraq and Afghanistan. And the diplomatic cables have been the ones that they've claimed had, in my view, worse impact, because they had to get people out of these countries who were working with the U.S. embassies. And there was anxiety, and no doubt they had to upend their lives. But nobody's ever shown that anyone was captured and tortured or interrogated by the Taliban, or that there was retaliation because they were informants of the U.S. military or because they were informants of the U.S. State Department. And it's simply my belief, as well as Daniel Ellsberg's and a lot of other people, that if these individuals existed, we would know their names, because the government has not hesitated at any moment to take advantage of a chance to demonize WikiLeaks. And so it's non-existent, the harm that they want to act like is out there. And so Ellsberg did a good job of challenging it. And he also made it clear, just very briefly to add here, that he made it clear that Julian Assange reached out to the State Department and the Defense Department for help redacting names from these documents, and they did not take him up on the offer. They rejected that. They said they weren't going to work with him on the materials, even though this is common in journalism. The New York Times does it all the time. Glenn Greenwald and Laura Poitras did this on the Snowden materials. That's how the NSA protected people in some of the most sensitive documents from the Snowden cache. And so Ellsberg was very clear in saying, hey, they bear some responsibility for the fact that people were exposed to any risk because they didn't take the opportunity. And he believed that they may have been doing this to preserve their opportunity or preserve the ability to prosecute Julian Assange later on by going, hey, lives were put at risk. And so it was important for him to take the stand and challenge a lot of the way the prosecution has been approaching this case.
That's interesting. I mean, because everything I've read about this case over the last 10 years and about Julian Assange over the last 10 years, and people who've interviewed him and conversations he's had, and all we know is that what you're saying here is a reality, is that he actually did his best to protect the leakers as opposed to exposing them. He wanted to expose the information that was going on, but not the people who actually leaked. I think that's something that many people don't realize. And that seems to be in some ways at the heart of the U.S.'s case to extradite him. So I mean, I'm no expert in British law, but how will that play out, do you think?
Yeah, so what you're getting at is that the U.S. government really wants this case to be about Julian Assange exposing the names of human intelligence sources or informants that were supposedly in the documents. And that's actually not a crime in the United States. We should be very clear about this. In the United States, it is not a crime for a journalist to publish the name of an informant. It's a crime for someone who is a government employee to publish the name of an informant. That's called the Intelligence Identities Protection Act. But after WikiLeaks, there was somewhat of a meek push by Senator Joe Lieberman and some other senators to pass a law that would have been that was known as the SHIELD Act, that would have been designed to protect human intelligence. And they never completed this work. They never actually passed a law, which we can draw a lot of conclusions about why that didn't happen. But one of the most important conclusions I think we should draw is it wasn't that important. It wasn't that much of a priority to make sure we criminalize this activity of publishing somebody who is an informant's name. And also, you know, the fact is that it would have run into First Amendment issues. And so they didn't do it. And so it's not a crime. And one of the aspects of the extradition case that the judge has to look at is, what are the allegations against Julian Assange? And are they actually crimes in the United States where he would be extradited? And that's an important thing, because we're looking at criminalization of receiving material passively, even if he didn't want it. Just the fact that he got it in his email is enough to make him someone who committed a crime, if you look at what the U.S. government's case is as they lay it out. And the fact that he worked on this material like any other journalist, they allege that he solicited leaks, and that's a common part of news gathering. So we've heard throughout most of this extradition trial, several witnesses talking about how what WikiLeaks does is standard news gathering. They've been demystifying it, trying to remove the stigma that is attached to it by the U.S. government and some other elite media organizations that criticize how WikiLeaks operates. And that is something the judge is going to look at when making a determination whether crimes were committed by Julian Assange. All she has to find is there has to be information that says there's reason to believe that a crime was committed. And if there's reason to believe a crime was committed, he'll likely be extradited.
So there are two issues here in the time we have together today. And I want to let you get some rest. You have a lot of work to do with this, but I think we need to cover. I mean, I remember 2016, you know, we had Donald Trump saying, "Oh, we love WikiLeaks," that he said at a rally in North Carolina, especially after the Democratic emails came out that cast some bad light on Hillary Clinton. And so let's just take a second here to kind of, and then he has these contradictions from today about saying, I don't know anything about Julian Assange and all the other things he said. This is a clip of all that.
WikiLeaks, I love WikiLeaks.
They want to distract us from WikiLeaks. It's been amazing what's coming out on WikiLeaks.
This WikiLeaks is like a treasure trove.
We've learned so much from WikiLeaks.
Oh, we love WikiLeaks.
Do you still love WikiLeaks?
I know nothing about WikiLeaks. It's not my thing. And I know there is something having to do with Julian Assange. I've been seeing what's happened with Assange, and that will be a determination, I would imagine, mostly by the Attorney General, who's doing an excellent job. So he'll be making a determination. I know nothing really about him. It's not my deal in life.
So I'm curious, why do you think all this is happening now with such ferocity under Trump? Not that the Obama administration is innocent of all the stuff that happened, but what is this ferocity about, do you think?
Yeah, and the other quote that I'll add in here is, or I think it comes from his Twitter account, where he actually was in favor of the death penalty for Julian Assange back in 2010 when these publications were first coming out. And so you go from hang him to he's great because he can help me beat Hillary Clinton to I don't really care because there are people in my administration who want to bring him down and I'm not going to get in the way. And I think that there's a feature of Donald Trump's administration where he's rhetorically been opposed to policies that are championed by right-wing forces or neoconservative forces. And he, you know, he'll use his campaign rallies to actually engage his supporters and whip them up in opposition to endless wars and, you know, say he doesn't want mass surveillance because he believes that's connected to how he was investigated for alleged Russian interference. And he'll do this, but then he'll empower people in his administration who continue these policies and he'll allow the wars to continue. And he won't do anything to stop, in this instance, the prosecution of a journalist who is being held in a maximum security prison in Britain in a case that is viewed as one of the most high stakes press freedom case in the history of the world in recent modern history. I think it's fair to put it in those terms. So one thing I want to make clear as we wrap up is that the prosecutors are absolutely frustrated with the fact that Barack Obama's administration did not go forward with this prosecution. So we need to stay focused on why the Obama administration chose not to prosecute and indict Julian Assange, and then why the Trump administration made the choice to do something differently and prosecute and indict Julian Assange, because that shows that there is politics at the center of this case. And a political case is one that is not fair, and it is one that suggests that he would not receive a fair trial if brought to the United States, because if it was just about committing a crime and violating laws, he would have been charged after Chelsea Manning. It just makes sense that after they convicted Chelsea Manning in a military court, they would have proceeded on with the most high-profile publisher involved, Julian Assange, who was already in the Ecuador embassy, and they could have at least issued an indictment that put everyone on notice that, you know, they were coming after him. And so they backed away because of the First Amendment issues. And those are not issues that Donald Trump respects. And so the legal team, to wrap this comment up, believe that this is all part of Trump's larger war on journalism. And it's also a part of him using the Justice Department to go after people who might challenge his administration. And so between Jeff Sessions and Mike Pompeo and Bill Barr, who is now the Attorney General, these are all figures who recognize that WikiLeaks could pose a threat. And this is about dismantling WikiLeaks from being able to challenge Donald Trump's administration.
And I covered some of that in some of the conversations I've had with Chelsea Manning on this for the Real News. And one of the things that strikes me here is, and it also came out, I think, in your Shadowproof article you posted with Barry Pollack, who's Assange's American U.S. lawyer, that this raises all kinds of issues. And you kind of touched on something, some of these now, and I think it's important to kind of probe them a little more deeply. That this kind of says the U.S. can take, as you were writing about, jurisdiction across the world, across the globe, to go after criminal charges against any journalist anywhere if they felt like it. I mean, there seems to be no defense for this under the First Amendment. The Espionage Act is maybe has gone after leakers, but not after journalists. So this turns everything on its head. And in a sense of creeping authoritarianism, this is a really dangerous precedent being set here. And I know that your conversation with Pollack had a lot to talk about that. Let's explore that for a minute.
Yeah, so what I'd also add, in addition to Barry Pollack, is James Goodall, who was the counsel for the New York Times when it came to the Pentagon Papers case in defending. And he's been an advocate in support of the right to publish for, as it is applied to Julian Assange and WikiLeaks. And he makes the point that they are being told, the prosecutors are telling the legal team, that Julian Assange has no First Amendment rights. And yet he's being prosecuted under a U.S. law. That doesn't make any sense. If you're being prosecuted under the Espionage Act, you should be able to have the protections that would come with being prosecuted under a U.S. law. And certainly that would be constitutional protections to your privacy, your free speech rights, right to not be cruelly and inhumanely treated, etc. He is not a U.S. citizen. He is an Australian citizen. He is, however, being told that even though he didn't sign a non-disclosure agreement and had no contract with the U.S. government to protect classified information, that he committed a crime by publishing that classified information. He's being told that he did something wrong by publishing classified information in which he was under no obligation to protect because he's not a citizen that's supposed to abide by secrecy laws or secrecy regulations in the United States. And so you very appropriately point us in the direction of what happens if this case is successful. We would probably see a green light go off, and all of these countries around the world that might have power would feel like they could go in the and follow in the footsteps of the United States government. So countries that we would recognize as having some kind of influence over regions, I'd say China, Russia, Israel, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, maybe Brazil in Latin America, I don't know, Mexico maybe. You could easily populate the list and see that they might decide that they want to do what the U.S. government has done and control the flow of information and go after people who have challenged them on government policies. And I'll end by saying that at the core of this prosecution is the belief on the part of the legal team that Julian Assange isn't simply being targeted because he published classified information, but because that information exposed U.S. war crimes and torture and shined a light on conduct that brought the U.S. government under scrutiny and forced accountability. And right now we have in the International Criminal Court an investigation playing out where they are looking into war crimes in Afghanistan committed by the U.S. government, CIA, U.S. military forces, coalition forces, Afghan militias, Afghan government-backed groups, Taliban. And at its core, there's evidence that WikiLeaks revealed, and there's people who were empowered by WikiLeaks disclosures who have become witnesses or are participants in this. And Donald Trump has sanctioned, his administration has sanctioned investigators in an unprecedented way, going after them for trying to hold the United States accountable. And WikiLeaks is at the center of this as well. I think we can put this case in the same category as the sanctions that are being brought against the International Criminal Court, because I think this is also not only a press freedom case, but it's about protecting impunity for U.S. crimes.
And what you're highlighting is really critically important, because this is about Assange clearly, but it's beyond Assange and WikiLeaks and how it could change the whole nature of law and freedom and the freedom of the press and more, and challenging what are war crimes in our planet. So First, Kevin Costola, thank you so much once again for being with us and for all the work you're doing on this. This is really critical. We look forward to talking to you more as the trial unfolds and to see what happens. So, Kevin, thanks so much and get some rest. We look forward to talking to you soon.
Thank you.
And I'm Mark Steiner here of the Real News Network. Let us know what you think. Thanks for watching. Take care.
Thanks a lot for watching. Appreciate it. But do us one more solemn favor. Hit the subscribe button below. You know you want to. Stay up on the videos.